Thank you very much for joining us here this afternoon. I would like to start by just noting that to date we've administered 1.8 million vaccination doses. When I checked the report this morning, we're at 999,800 who have received at least one dose. So we should be over the 1 million mark in terms of our residents starting the vaccination process. That's 70.3%. And to date, 881,000 of our residents have gotten fully vaccinated. That's 62% of the population. I do think there's been news stories of concern about the hospitals and ICUs filling up. And yes, in fact, we are seeing more COVID patients in our hospitals, and the ICUs are filling up. And so, as you're aware, the city and county had announced this morning that they would be canceling all events over 10 indoors and 25 outdoors. We fully support that action. We know that we need to take action now in order to reduce the spread of COVID and ensure that our hospitals are not overrun. We are increasing our efforts to provide testing across the state. We do know that testing is helping us identify those who are sick, but we do know that these actions will take time to make an impact on the COVID cases that we're seeing. It will take 6 to 7 weeks in order for us to see significant change in the number of cases. So I ask everyone to do your part. We know what's necessary in order for us to reduce the spread of COVID here in our state. It is about wearing our masks, washing our hands, and using hand sanitizer, getting vaccinated. That's the most important thing that anyone can do to help us get back to normal. I would like to note that Pfizer was granted full approval by the FDA this morning. I know that several had told me that they would not get vaccinated until the vaccine was fully approved. We know that the vaccines continue to be very effective against the Delta variant and other variants that have become of interest here in the state of Hawaii as well as across the country. We know that the vaccines are effective at preventing death and severe illness, including hospitalizations. But we do know what action is successful in reducing the spread of COVID-19. It's maintaining physical distancing, 6 feet from everyone. If you are sick, stay home. Even if you become mildly symptomatic, or if you've had a close contact with someone that was positive, you need to isolate and stay away from others. Wear your mask indoors, and I wear my mask outdoors as well, as long as I believe that there'll be a crowd and I won't be able to maintain physical distancing of 6 feet. And I certainly encourage everyone to avoid large gatherings. I applaud the action taken by the city and county to restrict all gatherings over 10 indoors and 25 outdoors. We definitely need to take action to reduce the spread of COVID-19. It is a risky time to be traveling right now. I did ask everyone, residents and visitors alike, to reduce travel to Hawaii to essential business activities only. We do know that it is not a good time to travel to the islands. Restaurant capacity has been restricted. There is limited access to rental cars. And we know that the visitors who choose to come to the islands will not have the typical kind of holiday that they expect to get when they visit Hawaii. So once again, I encourage everyone to restrict and curtail travel to Hawaii. Residents and visitors alike, it's not a good time to travel to the islands. We all know the actions that's necessary to reduce the spread of COVID. It's about wearing your mask indoors and outdoors if you can't maintain physical distance, staying home when you're sick, washing your hands and using hand sanitizer, and especially avoiding large gatherings and crowds. If we all can take these actions for the next 4 weeks, we can bend the curve of COVID-19 here in the state of Hawaii.
Thank you very much, Governor. We'll open it up to questions from the media. Please, reporters, raise your virtual hand and we'll call on you. If you have a follow-up to your initial question, please raise your hand again so I know not to mute you and move on. We'll start with Dan Micasso, Star Advertiser. Go ahead, Dan.
Thank you, Jody. My question is for Governor Ige. I'll ask it as he approaches. You said on Spotlight Hawaii this morning that you hope people heed your request to curtail travel through the end of October, which of course you know is the sort of the end of our shoulder season or traditional slowdown in the economy. How concerned are you that if people heed that, especially visitors, that might push some small businesses to go belly up?
I am certainly aware that many of our businesses are currently struggling. I do know that when we reimpose the restriction on restaurants to 50% of capacity, I heard from many restaurants about the challenges that would present. And certainly our call to reduce travel to the islands to only essential businesses will have an impact on the numbers who have come here. But I also would like to point out that our hospitals are at capacity. Our ICUs are full. We are working on surge plans at every facility to expand capacity. We're transitioning acute care beds to be able to support those who are sick. And so I do know that that's a risk, but I believe that as a community, that's a risk we have to take to discourage travel to the islands until we can get to a better place with our healthcare facilities.
Thank you, Governor. Wendy Osher, Maui Now. Go ahead, Wendy.
Hi, Governor. Other than Honolulu, are you considering mitigation requests from outer island mayors, specifically for Maui County?
Yes, I did have a discussion with Mayor Victorino this morning, and we'll be re-engaging this afternoon. Have been talking with Hawaii Island and Kauai as well. Certainly, we are all concerned with the surging cases and have been monitoring hospital capacity all across the state. So I will be looking at Mayor Victorino's request about further restrictions on Maui.
All right, moving on to Daryl Huff, Hawaii News Now. Daryl.
Question for the governor. With the formal approval of the Pfizer vaccine, can you get tougher with your employees about your vaccine or testing mandate? It seems like many will be going to testing because it's being provided free. With this new approval, can you actually make it mandatory? Are you considering that?
There's a couple of things, Darryl, and I should have a complete assessment this afternoon from all the departments and agencies. The data that I actually saw was very encouraging. The rate of vaccination among state employees is high, higher than I thought it would be initially. So, you know, Darryl, I think all of us really believe that public servants would choose to get vaccinated. We've seen public servants step up for the entire pandemic, and they have been willing to go beyond the call in their duties, accepting responsibilities that are outside of their scope because they knew that it would help support our communities. So I'm encouraged. We'll have a much better assessment by the end of the day today. But I do believe that we'll have quite good participation rate under the existing policies.
Daryl, did you have a follow-up?
Yeah, can you be a little more specific, please, particularly when it comes to public safety workers, prison guards, and teachers? Can you give me give us a general number as opposed to what you were able to say? A little bit more specific.
Well, Daryl, the challenge is I don't have the complete picture for example, on all the schools, but I have seen some districts that the vaccination rate was higher than the statewide average for sure. And so, you know, I don't have anything other than spot information, and I don't want to misspeak at this point. We will have a comprehensive report by the end of the day.
All right, going on to Tom George, KITV. Tom?
This question is for the governor. Also, in light of the FDA approving the vaccine, you know, we're hearing some municipalities across the country considering health passes or, you know, having a way to require vaccination to get into public accommodations. Is that something that is being considered here in Hawaii?
We have been encouraging vaccinations, at least for the very urgently, through a wide range of the incentive programs for the last several months. We will be looking at, now that we have full use authorization from the FDA for the Pfizer vaccine, about what further steps we can take. We've had discussions about health pass. The current tier system does recognize businesses and encourages businesses who are willing to have all of their customers vaccinated. They have been authorized to be able to get to higher densities. And we continue to work with the industry, talking with the Restaurant Association and the Retail Association and the business community in general. I can tell you that there is concern as virtually every business is hiring people, that they are having trouble hiring the employees that they need. Many businesses have expressed a concern about having additional mandates have an impact on their ability to hire employees and to be able to serve the general public.
All right, thank you, Governor. Jennifer Kelleher, Associated Press. Jen.
Hi, Governor. The Native Hawaiian community is being hit hard now with the number of cases and vaccine hesitancy. And a reason many give is the distress for government and Hawaii's history. What is being done to improve vaccination rates among Hawaii's indigenous people?
You know, we are reaching out to leaders and organizations active amongst Native Hawaiians and the indigenous groups. We do know that sometimes my making statements are not the most motivational for many others, and so we are partnering with Native Hawaiian organizations, as well as identifying leaders within those communities who support vaccination and who can speak out to encourage others to get vaccinated. You know, we've done advertising with Native Hawaiian doctors asking and encouraging Native Hawaiians to get vaccinated, stressing the fact that the vaccinations have proven to be safe and effective. And so we certainly are aware that Native Hawaiians are not getting vaccinated at the same rate as others in our community. And we are working very hard with community-based partners to try to make vaccines more available, to find different voices to encourage Native Hawaiians to get vaccinated. And certainly We are open to any other organization that has ideas about how we can do a better job of responding to the Native Hawaiian community, getting the answers to questions that they might have that promotes hesitancy. And I think most importantly, you know, we are concerned and we are doing everything that we can think of to reach this population.
Thank you, Governor. Going to Stuart Yurton, Civil Beat. Stuart.
Yes, thank you, Jody. Governor Ige, you mentioned this morning that the airlines had, you had met with the airlines and they said that they would help amplify the message that this isn't the best time to come here. Which airlines did you talk to and did they express the concern that this would affect their business at a time when they're really just trying to bounce back?
Certainly, I am fully aware that all the airlines continue to struggle. There was general understanding of what the healthcare situation is in our islands. And certainly there was an acknowledgement that it is a difficult time here in the state. And they did express support for helping in the ways that they can. To deliver the message that it's not a good time to visit the islands.
All right, moving on to, Stuart, did you have a follow-up?
Yes, a follow-up. It would seem like it would be pretty easy for airlines to, and hotels for that matter too, to raise fares to a point where only people who really had to travel would travel. Was there any discussion about them limiting the numbers of people by making fares so high that people wouldn't want to come?
I am prohibited from talking about fares or scheduling with airlines. It would be an antitrust violation. So I did not talk specifically about fares or schedules or flights, but spoke with them about the current situation here for our healthcare system. And certainly asked them to do whatever they could to help reduce travel to the islands.
All right, Nikki Shenfield, KHON2.
Yes, Governor, if the hospitals are at capacity and the ICU beds are full, what is the trigger point you would say something like a lockdown is necessary, and how close are we to it?
You know, we are initiating surge plans in every facility, and Libby is here and she can talk to more specifically. I think you've seen the tents that have popped up at the facilities, and those are kind of extensions. They're tents that allow us to treat acute care patients that may need less than ICU support, but allows us to extend the personnel in the hospitals to be able to take care of more people. So what is happening all across the state is that hospitals are looking at regular acute care beds and transitioning them to be able to take ICU patients. You know, there are other activities that are geared toward creating more spaces for COVID positive patients within that hospital. And we are working within the existing physical structures in the hospitals across the state to expand capacity to serve more. And I'll stop there and let Dr. Char give you more specifics about actions that we're taking to ensure that we can provide health care to all of those who need it.
Thank you, Governor. So just to commend the hospital system and our partners with the Healthcare Association of Hawaii, they have been doing an amazing job of all pitching in to help each other out. So it seems like we still have some capacity for medical surgical type beds in some of the facilities, and the ICU beds are what they're having more of a challenge with ICU beds. This past weekend was really tight, and so I think it's a matter of trying to rebalance the healthcare system. And so several facilities stepped up to offload patients from another facility, and that's where I think it's just commendable that the healthcare system is really, really working together to rebalance things so that all of them can provide really high quality care to the patients that they have in their facilities. We are also very thankful that we got some surge staffing in today, and there was some that came in last week and went to Kona and Hilo. So today we've got a bunch more people in, and that's going to help tremendously to give a little bit of breathing room to all of the hospital facilities. So, you know, we're watching very carefully. There are conversations daily. And again, it's just a real, real solid partnership between all of the healthcare systems as well as the Healthcare Association of Hawaii, and we're very grateful for that.
Thank you, Dr. Char. Zoe Dim, Hawaii Public Radio. Zoe.
This is a question for the governor.
Go ahead.
What are some of the specific actions that will be taken to limit the number of travelers to Hawaii?
You know, we are going to be requesting all of our travel partners to communicate the fact that it's not a good time to be traveling to the islands. We would note that we've added restrictions to to restaurants. So there are will be limited access to restaurants and other places to eat. We continue to have a shortage of rental cars here. So, you know, we've asked the Hawaii Tourism Authority to help us inform those in the hospitality industry about what the current situation is. And we know that they will be helping in the way that they can to curtail travel to the islands.
All right, Stephanie Sammons, Hawaii Tribune Herald. Stephanie?
Hey, this is, I guess, either for the governor or Dr. Char. What happens if or when we can't expand surge capacity at hospitals anymore, whether that's either because of space or staffing? What happens if we reach that point?
We do have expansion or surge plans that entail, for example, and we talked about it last year, about whether we would be able to retrofit a convention center or other facility to be able to service additional patients. The challenge that we will face at this point, when I checked the CDC site this morning, the entire country is lit up red as extremely high activity of COVID in every single state across the country. And lots of those surge plans that deal with establishing a field hospital or a facility to expand capacity relies on federal support for doctors and medical professionals to help staff that surge hospital. We don't believe that we would be in a position to get support because every state is facing the similar situation to what we're seeing right now. And I'll let Dr. Char add.
And we've been having a lot of discussions for several months now about the hospital capacity and surge capacity. I'm reminded that for the past 10 Mondays, we've seen our numbers go up. So I think it was maybe June 21st or somewhere thereabouts, we were at like 14 cases, and we have just steadily climbed since then. So really the question to me is, what are we doing to prevent us being in that situation where our hospitals are overrun and we're looking at further surge capacity? And that gets back to all of us, you know, what have you done to prepare? You know, in the past 10 days since we first floated that, we have been ramping up testing. We are trying to increase the capacity of our isolation and quarantine facilities. You know, we're trying to onboard more people. We're trying to increase the capacity for the contact tracing and the case investigation. And it's been really tough because we just don't have that many more people on this island to help do those things. But, you know, what have we done? And I think that's where, you know, it's really commendable that the city and county has stepped up and they're limiting the gathering size, because I think that'll help greatly. But we need to do the prevention side of things so that we never get to the treatment side or having, you know, surge capacity in hospitals. What are we doing? So we need to back down on our gatherings. We need to prevent ourselves or our loved ones from becoming another case and adding to that hospital load. We need to stay home. We need to wear our masks. We need to keep our distance. And I think we really need to reframe it like that. What are we doing to keep the hospitals from being overrun? Because it's our community, it's our hospitals, and it's up to us, and we can impact that.
Thank you, Dr. Char. Max Dybul, go ahead. Max, Big Island Now.
Thank you. This is for the governor. Governor, this ties into just what Dr. Char was just saying. Your administration, the Department of Health, are asking the population of this state to stay home, to wear masks, to take responsibility. But on the front end of this pandemic, that was not what was done. It was mandates from your office to lock down. And I don't want to say definitively, but we keep looking over the last several days, the last several weeks, numbers keep rising. It doesn't appear as though the population of this state is responding as you would like them to. So it was mentioned by a reporter earlier about lockdowns being on the table. That wasn't addressed specifically. I'm curious, are they on the table, and what conditions would demand them?
Yeah, so I know that that question has been asked before, and it's difficult to give you specific conditions that would trigger a lockdown. But yes, is a lockdown on the table? Yes, it would be. If the number of cases continues to grow exponentially as it has in the last 10 weeks, as Dr. Char had said, then we will have to take action to limit and ensure that the hospitals are not overwhelmed. And I don't have a specific number, but certainly we're in contact with the hospitals every single day about their current situation, about the number of patients they are seeing, and about their capacity to continue to serve our community with quality health care.
All right, Melissa Tanji, Maui News.
Hi, this message is, this question is for Dr. Char. Dr. Char, do you think today's FDA approval of the Pfizer, the full approval of the Pfizer vaccine, will actually help here in Hawaii? And maybe what percentage or number of the unvaccinated population you think would, you know, be receptive to this news and get vaccinated?
I sure hope it will help. You know, a lot of the reasons when we ask people who haven't been fully vaccinated why, a lot of them are saying, well, you know, they thought it was a little too soon, or they didn't have enough confidence, they were worried, or, you know, even some claims that the vaccine was experimental, which we know it absolutely was not. So I'm really hopeful that for those people, this will make a difference for them. And I just would remind everybody, you know, this is the most studied, scrutinized, tracked vaccine in the history of mankind. We know it's safe. We know it works. It keeps people from severe illness, from hospitalization, from death. I mean, we know it works. So maybe this full FDA approval for those 16 and older will be enough to take those people who are hesitant and make them feel comfortable enough to go and get vaccinated.
Thank you, Dr. Char. Go ahead, Dan Nicasso, Star Advertiser.
Thanks, Jody. I wanted to follow up on Melissa's question to Dr. Char to ask the same of Governor Ige. As you know, there's no shortage of conspiracies online about what's in the vaccine. You and Mayor Blangiardi and other elected officials have been told repeatedly that's the lack of FDA approval, that's the hesitancy. How optimistic, or on the other hand, how pessimistic are you that that was just a red herring for people not to get vaccinated, and that because of the FDA approval today, suddenly those numbers of vaccinated people will jump significantly beyond the 70% level?
Just a couple of things, and you know, on the White House calls that we've been having on a weekly basis, they have provided survey data that they're doing across the country, and they reported that of those who said that they are not vaccinated, that 70 to 80% of those who are unvaccinated had a reason for not being vaccinated. And I do recall when we look at the numbers, the fact that there wasn't full use authorization and the fact that it was an emergency use authorization only was one of the higher reasons given for those who are not vaccinated. So we don't have specific numbers for here in Hawaii, but we have heard that when those who are unvaccinated are asked about why they're not vaccinated, a good number are saying it's because it's emergency use authorization only, and that they would be waiting for a full use authorization. So, you know, I guess we'll remain, we'll be watching carefully about what an impact it has. You know, as we've said, we do believe that for state workers, we hope to see a high compliance with the vaccination mandate. And certainly with this announcement, we'll see how many who have chosen to wait will decide to get vaccinated now.
Thank you, Gov. Daryl Huff, HNN. Go ahead, Daryl.
Thank you. For Dr. Char and also for the governor, what you folks are describing is a very critical situation when it comes to the hospitals. If they're operating at 110 or 120% now and they have no ICU beds now, how much longer is it until you define it as being out of control or the crisis level to which a lockdown would be necessary to respond? If you don't have surge capability, how many more people can you take into the hospitals before you have to say nobody can go outside anymore?
Yeah, you know, certainly, Daryl, it might sound like it's a simple calculation, but it is very complex. As Dr. Char had mentioned, you know, one of the triggers for Queens West saying that they were overwhelmed was because many patients showed up at Queens West and there was still sufficient capacity at other hospitals around the state, especially on Oahu. So, you know, we are working, yes, we are very much concerned with the continuing high case numbers that we're seeing. We know that our hospitals are working very hard to be able to treat everyone. I wish I could tell you that there's a specific magic number at which point we will look at a lockdown, but there isn't. It really is about working with the healthcare system, taking the actions that we can to be able to expand services and capacity. And then at the point that we feel that we don't have any other resources to expand capacity, then certainly we will have to look at more drastic action.
Okay, looks like Daryl has a follow-up. Daryl?
I guess what I'm concerned about is that you're making statements to encourage the public to do this or that, to encourage businesses to do this or that, but you're not making them do this or that. You know, for example, the businesses that we spoke with last week said they need a government mandate in order to do vaccine health passes because one business doing it and another one does it, and it's not fair, and they run into all kinds of conflicts. They need the government to sort of back them up. Same thing being true of vaccine requirements for employees and public service businesses. You keep saying, oh, this is a really good idea, They're saying, we need your help to do it. When are you going to get to the point where you actually tell businesses to do these things in order to keep us safe?
Well, and I think that that's the balancing act, Daryl. For every business that encourages me to mandate it, there are other businesses who tell me that they're on the brink of closure and the mandate would push them over the edge. So certainly it is about trying to find the right balance. We do recognize that mandates impacts many in our community, and to the extent that we can encourage action, you know, that would be preferable, but we are prepared to mandate action if necessary when we get to the breaking point.
Okay, Jennifer Kelleher, Associated Press. Go ahead, Jennifer.
Thanks. Hi, Governor. It really seems like nothing so far has discouraged visitors from coming or residents from traveling during a pandemic, other than strict travel restrictions and quarantine measures. And even when we had those in place, people were still coming and getting arrested for violating rules. What can you say to those who say there needs to be more done than simply asking people to limit travel to essential purposes?
Well, you know, last year in March, when I first asked for visitors to postpone travel to the islands, we saw a 60% reduction in the traffic to Hawaii. And then certainly ordering the mandatory quarantine of all incoming visitors reduced travel to the islands by 99.5%, essentially 100% of travelers. The situation that we are in today is different with the availability of vaccines, and here in the islands with 62% of our community being fully vaccinated, and all across the country, a good number of people are fully vaccinated. And the CDC guidance is about fully vaccinated individuals being able to travel domestically. I think that that's the different situation that we currently are in. You know, we have been monitoring travel to the islands, and we do see a reduction in travel to the islands of about 14% already. You know, we are hoping to see a larger reduction in travel to the islands as we proceed during this time.
Thank you very much, Governor. Tom George, KITV4. Tom?
Governor, you know, one of the initial incentives just as a community to get vaccinated was you set this 70% target. Is that still in place right now, or has the Delta variant changed that? And is that something that, if that does change, might discourage people from getting vaccinated?
Certainly with the Delta variant and the fact that it is more transmissible, that does change the dynamic and the target at which point we would arrive at herd immunity. You know, we continue to encourage everybody to get vaccinated because that's the best way to get out of the current situation. We haven't set a new target on vaccinations at this point in time. You know, we are monitoring, and with the surge in the cases, it's certainly obvious that we are far from herd immunity today. The virus is actively being spread in our community all across the state. And so, you know, what that new target would be, I think, is at least several weeks away before we can assess where we are. And make a determination about at what point and at what level of vaccinations we would achieve herd immunity and see the number of cases be stable.
Tom, did you have a follow-up?
Yes, I did. Also, just in terms of travel, I mean, at your last press conference, you said, you know, it was only 1 to 2% of all cases were from actual visitors. You know, in announcing this today, do you feel like we are maybe under-reporting that? Or where do things stand in terms of visitors versus locals as the cause of new cases?
We've actually seen in the last week a reduction in the number of cases that are due to travel-related visitors as well as residents. So certainly it seems like less residents are traveling right now, which is, I think, a good thing. But, you know, those numbers change all the time, and we continue to monitor them. We do believe that the number of cases due to visitors remains low, but we are recognizing that the high level of virus activity in our community, we just want to encourage everyone to defer travel to the islands except for essential businesses. We do believe that that would be best for our community right at this point in time. We know that that will have an impact on economic recovery, but the health condition of our community requires us to take action. Right. And I think Dr. Char is going to add.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So one of the issues with the travel-related infections is it's a percentage of the total number of cases. So as we see our total number of cases skyrocket, even though the number, absolute number of visitors and travel-related infections goes up, as a percentage of the total number of cases, it's relatively diminished. So I think we're seeing, you know, single digits on travel-related cases, but that's the percentage. And we know that our overall numbers are so high, it's kind of dwarfing that. And all that really tells us is that yes, we have cases related to travel. The vast majority of our cases right now are related to community transmission, just widespread community transmission. So really, that's where we need to be focusing a lot of our energy.
Thank you, Dr. Char. Stuart Yurden, Civil Beat. Stuart.
Yes, thank you, Jody. Yes, this is for Dr. Char. Another question related to vaccinations and the current surge. Dr. Char, do you see any evidence that this recent spike in cases has made people more likely or encouraged people to get vaccines? Are you seeing more, any evidence that people are getting vaccinated because of the current surge?
Yeah, thankfully we are seeing a little bit of a bump in our numbers in terms of the number of vaccine doses administered. We started seeing that, I guess it's been several weeks now, once we started hitting the 160 a day kind of case numbers, we saw a small bump, and it seems like it's accelerated a little bit more. So we are back to, I think, roughly in the 20,000 doses per week range. And so we hope that that's sustained, because we really would like for everybody to get vaccinated in order to create a safer community for all of us.
Thank you, Dr. Char. Stephanie Sammons, go ahead. Hawaii Tribune Herald.
Hi, this is for the governor. I was wondering if you have approved the most recent emergency rule and restrictions that have been proposed by Mayor Roth here on the Big Island. And do you think that those go far enough to curb the spread here?
I haven't been able to complete the review of the request from Mayor Roth. And so I know he's asked in our meeting this morning that we try and approve it today, and we are working to complete that review.
Okay, thank you very much, Governor. Stuart, I need to apologize. I think you had a follow-up, and I bypassed you. Go ahead. Stuart?
Yeah, sorry. This was, again, for Dr. Char. Is there any way to quantify or any sense of how many or how much the approval of the Pfizer vaccine could increase people's desire to get vaccinated? I know Governor Ige talked a little bit about some information that it is a reason, the emergency use authorization is a reason that people are reluctant. But are there any numbers? Do you know how much this could move the needle?
I really don't. I don't know how many more people will get vaccinated. I'm hoping that it's a lot, but I don't know the number.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Char. Dan Micasso, Star Advertiser, round three. Go ahead.
Thanks, Jody. A question for Governor. Given the fluid situation and the increasing concerns, are you considering the eviction moratorium that's scheduled to be lifted? Is that an issue that might be put back in play given all that's going on?
you know, we are implementing the new laws concerning evictions that the legislature passed this session. You know, the desire or the requirement that mediation occur, it's, I think, a powerful tool to reduce the number of evictions. We believe that it's best to proceed with ending the moratorium. It does, we've heard from both landlords and tenants about the concerns about evictions, but also about the need to really move forward, because some of the landlords really are unable to make decisions about their properties until the moratorium ends. So we know that the rental relief programs on all of the counties have been very active. They've accepted many applications. We meet with them on a regular basis every week to find out status on the distribution of rent relief funds. We are asking and encouraging both landlords and tenants who are behind in rent to apply for rental assistance. I would like to remind people that the rental assistance program also allows you to request for future rent assistance, not only for those payments that someone is behind, but also those that they may be struggling to pay throughout the end of the year. So, you know, we believe that ending the moratorium is a step forward to getting back to normal in our rental markets. We believe that the rental assistance funds hopefully can help bridge the gap between landlords and tenants and support landlords in keeping tenants in place and not having to evict them.
Okay, we'll go with a couple things. Are you okay, Dan?
Yes, thank you, Governor.
Okay. Daryl Huff, HNN.
Hi, this is for Dr. Char. You know, we've become aware that the testing that's being offered at the stadium, and I think at a number of the other free states, free sites, are often antigen tests. And I had one expert tell me today that if state workers are being allowed to use an antigen test to satisfy your requirement that they be exempt from vaccines, that the antigen test will not be effective in keeping the virus out of your workplaces, because you need to take an antigen test every few days, not once a week or once every 2 weeks. Do you agree with that as an assessment? And what is your feeling about the effectiveness of antigen testing for the general public being used in this way?
I think what we need to remember about tests are that they are tools. So there's no one right tool for everything, and it really depends on how it's used. And it's also a balancing act in terms of the logistics of it and the feasibility. Certainly with antigen test, if you can test somebody every other day, you know, three times a week, that's probably a better test and a better result than testing somebody once. But also if people are symptomatic and you get an antigen test, you're done. You don't need to go on to do, you know, PCR on them necessarily. You can assume that that person has COVID. So it really depends on the setting in which it's done. I think primarily the testing at the stadium was set up so that people who were exposed or who were having symptoms could get tested. And it's better than not having any testing or having to go and, you know, go to a physician or a healthcare provider and get a prescription or, you know, go get a lab test ordered by them. So we're just trying to make testing as widespread and as available as we can for as many people as we can to try and answer those questions. We are seeing, you know, a fair amount of tests being done, and we're seeing a fair amount of test positivity. So I think the answer is that it's not the perfect test, and maybe, you know, you could tweak it a bit, but for what we're trying to accomplish and the number of people that we're dealing with and the rapidity of the results, because that's the other thing. We want the results right away so you know before you leave whether or not you tested positive. And so that's one of the reasons that we're using the point-of-care antigen testing at the community sites. Some of them were using PCR tests. It just depends.
Thank you, Dr. Char. We have time for one more question. Go ahead, Tom George, KITV4.
Yeah, just to clarify for the governor about the health passes. I mean, you mentioned businesses and their ability to hire, but you know, more so for customers and people feeling safe to go out. I mean, if you did mandate that, it would be an even playing field essentially. So, and there are proposals on the table right now. I know the Speaker of the House, Psyche, had mentioned that he was calling on you to do that. Is that something that you would consider of the plans that are out there?
Yeah, certainly we are considering the health passes. You know, we're working through the technical details about how we would implement. We are also looking at how the health passes have been implemented in other jurisdictions, other cities that have ordered it. There is no state that I believe has mandated the health pass. I know that several states have allowed it to be a voluntary activity. And so we are looking at all of those states, looking at which businesses and industries are involved in the mandate, what alternatives to vaccination are provided and supported. And then we continue to talk to businesses here in the islands to get an assessment of what the mandate, what impact the mandate would have on their businesses.
Right, Governor, your closing remarks.
I just really wanted to thank everyone and remind everyone that we do know what we need to do in order to help slow the spread of COVID-19 in our community. It is about staying home when we're sick and keeping our children home when they become sick. It's wearing our mask indoors, and certainly I would encourage you to wear a mask outdoors if you'll be going into a crowded location or to where you can't maintain physical distance. Wash your hands and use hand sanitizer as that helps to slow the spread of COVID-19. And I think most importantly, encourage everyone to get vaccinated. Getting vaccinated is the most effective way that we can manage the spread of COVID-19 and get back to normal. Thank you.